Rewind and Digress is a FakeShamp.net podcast proudly presented by Viewlorium. Alternative movies, alternative streaming, totally free at Viewlorium.com.
Welcome to Rewind and Digress, where we hit pause on the now and track back to one of our favourite films, discuss it at length, and occasionally stray off topic. Like Johnny with his pecker in his hand, he's a one ball man and he's off to the rodeo. I'm Jarrett and I'm with Glenn and Sean and we're FakeShamp.net. On this episode, we're rewinding back to 1992 for Stephen King's Sleepwalkers, directed by Mick Garris. Now, gentlemen, before I ask anything of you, I just wanted to say hi.
Oh, g'day.
Hello.
Just to acknowledge that you're actually here. Proof of life. I'm going to kick it off with the synopsis for the film, just to let everyone know what we're going to be talking about. I mean, if they haven't seen it, they probably should watch it before they listen to this, but otherwise, just keep listening, and this is your enticement to want to see the film. The official synopsis from the studio says, Brian Krause and Alice Krieg star in this terrifying tale of modern-day vampires who prey on virtuous young women. Madchen Amick plays Tonya, the sexually curious virgin who falls for the new boy in school, Charles, played by Brian Krause, only to learn too late that he's a life-sucking sleepwalker. Mutating at will from golden boy to savage monster, Krause stalks Amick to feed his seductive mother, Miss Brady. As the tension mounts and the casualties pile up, the town's tabbies gather for a final chilling showdown with the monsters in their midst. And we all know it's not nice to hurt people's felines. Clever little pun at the end there, gents.
Now, that's an official synopsis, right?
Yeah,
it made
like
no
the
fucking sense
I don't
whatsoever.
Know. I read it and I was like, that's not too bad. Is like, I've read a lot worse.
Yeah. I've read a lot worse.
Yeah. Since we've been doing this podcast, I've read a lot of bad studio synopsis for these films.
I've written a lot worse.
But let's get cracking into it. So, look, Sean, when was the very first time you saw Sleepwalkers?
Well, probably I'd have been about 12, 13. It was one of those ones because in the UK, here is rated R, yeah.
Well, actually, in the movies, it was rated M, but on video, they released it in a harder R-rated version. Yeah. More incest.
Oh, really? Same cut?
Yeah. No. Slightly longer cut. I think there was probably more sexuality. Probably more sexuality than there were gore or violence.
Yeah, right. I'd been about 12 and I've been back in the video store days, you know, seven for 10 or whatever it was that we used to get. And it was one of the ones I picked up. And I picked it up mostly because big fan of Stephen King.
Yeah.
And at the time, you know, when I saw that Stephen King, you know, wrote the story, because correct me if I'm wrong, he wrote it for the screen.
It's a direct screenplay.
And when I was a kid, I can't read this. I can't read that. I have to see this. This is one that I have to see to know. And like, so it became, but of course.
I think it was the second time you ever wrote directly for the screen. The first time would have been
Maximum Overdrive.
No, that was Trucks.
No, it was an episode of Tales from the Dark Side. Which he wrote as in the actual book, the anthology book, that's written as a play. Not a story.
But as an episode. So this might be the first movie?
Probably the first movie, then he did Rose Red, Storm of the Century and all
right,
that kind of stuff.
Okay.
But this time it was a novelty.
Yeah, totally.
And my dad was a fan of Alice Krieg.
Oh, God, I'm a fan of Alice Krieg as well.
Borg Queen?
Yeah, the Borg Queen.
Well,
yeah.
I'm also from Ghost Story, you know, Fred Astaire film.
Yeah.
And God help me, she was super attractive in that.
Even in Sleepwalkers, she's really...
My wife says, why doesn't she ever wear a bra?
Yeah, who cares?
Exactly.
You're looking for logic in a movie, you shouldn't. Yeah, that's somebody else's problem. Yeah, so my dad was a big fan of Alice Krieg. Right. And it was, the Borg Queen, that's where I recognized her from. I was like, oh my God, it's the Borg Queen. My dad goes, yeah. Like, she's Sleepwalkers, and, you know, yeah. So then we ended up, you know, my dad's obviously a big fan of Sleepwalkers. So
that's cool.
That's how I watched it, and it was, and again, 12-year-old, like, it was just, it was gory, and it was, you know, fucking...
That was probably only a couple years after it came out then. So
yeah,
like,
it was, it really was.
Home video,
yeah,
sort
it
of.
Really wasn't that long. But yeah, I was super impressed when I was a kid.
Awesome. Not a bit self, Glenn, was the first time
home
you
video.
Saw this.
Home video. I had no knowledge of the theatrical release back then.
Right.
But the cover was one of those that struck me as R-rated and cool, and
it's
I was
cool
into
cover.
Stephen King as well. I think, was this around the time of the Tommyknockers? there.
Yeah, it would have been. Probably about, yeah, because it would have been 93. Yeah, Tommy Knocker's is 93, 94-ish,
It was an era.
It was like,
it was an era when Stephen King was dominating video shelves. Totally. And the cover for this one was very cool.
It was cool. It was very subtle, but it was cool.
Yeah.
But good use of color.
Striking in this use of color. You know what?
Red, green, faces black. Yeah.
But you know what? When I was young and I was watching it, and I watched it quite a lot, and I think I made a copy of it at one point in time, so I could watch as much as I wanted.
Part alert.
But I remember at that age thinking it looked very much like a DTV kind of movie as opposed to theatrical. But having gone back and watched it twice this year, suddenly I'm like, no, it's way more cinematic than I thought it was.
Yeah. Totally.
Like, it actually, a lot of these films that you remember feeling DTV actually had a lot more merit to them when you watch in retrospect. So that's
well, that's the thing. You grow up and you kind of appreciate film as an art form, and you can see like even the cinematography, and you're like, wow, they've used a crane for this, and they've used a helicopter to get this shot as opposed to like a drone these days. All these things that they do, and you're like, fuck, there's production value where you don't normally look when you're not looking for that stuff.
And you know what I think made it feel DTV for me at the time was that it was that era where they were starting to bring digital effects into different things. So when he has the face morph, and when
a lot of morphing effects.
It felt tacky to me at the time. Which, because it was new
technology. And
so
it was weird.
I just remember thinking, oh, no wonder this came straight to video. Not realizing.
I will say the morphing in this film, I still think holds up. Actually looks pretty cool. In my opinion, it actually looks better than an entire Brett Leonard film. I'm just going to throw Brett Leonard under the bus on every podcast I can. Sorry, guys.
Yeah, two of us love you, mate.
I think one of the most, in an odd way, it's a striking vis effect shot, is when he makes the car disappear. You know, like when he's wounded, he makes the car disappear. And I would assume, and I could be wrong, I would assume that it's a motion control shot, right? Mm-hmm. Because the car eventually fades away, and you know. But I remember thinking, this shot is way too self aware, like that. This must have been something pretty special in the day. I could be wrong, but I don't know. It just feels a bit too on the nose.
Right.
Like something that could be...
You know what? You had Terminator 2 had come and revolutionized CG at the time.
Yeah.
And so that was the standard that everyone held to. So when something like this comes along, it feels far less, you know...
And that's the weird thing. There was only really probably...
A year?
Less than a year. Yeah. Because, I mean, Terminator 2 would open in the US during the summer of 91. We got it in September 91. And Sleepwalkers would have opened in about March, I think, of 92. And we got it actually 2 or 3 months later. So it really wasn't that much time. But you're right. It had come and it revolutionized. And we realized what could be done. So when this comes out and you kind of see something, you're like, it's good.
Yeah, it's okay.
But I think at the same time, if you're a genre fan, you're kind of like, this is like the best thing we've ever seen in a horror movie.
But then
though.
You've got the story is good.
Yeah, and that's absolutely. And completely original
the
story.
The discrepancy in the budgets of those two. Because Terminator 2 was like, at the time, it was the most expensive film ever made.
Absolutely.
And that
absolutely.
Shot of the T-1000 coming out the flame.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That but was like the most expensive shot ever committed to film at the time. Like,
but I'm talking about a child's perception of what I saw.
Oh, yeah, of course. True, exactly. We're not completely aware of these things. Now, I'm going to mention the first time I saw this film, I was on my very first trip to the States with my family, with my mum and my sister. And before, it would have been probably about March. It was actually the weekend before the film opened in the US. So we were seeing TV spots left, right, and center for this thing. And I was so hyped for it. Lawnmower Man was playing in the US at the time in theaters.
Probably under Stephen King's banner at the
and
time.
And it was Brett Leonard as well.
Yeah, it was.
Funnily enough. But no, I wanted to see Lawnmower Man, but I not that it wasn't allowed, but the group basically voted for Wayne's World, so we saw Wayne's World, and at that point that was completely alien to me because Wayne's World SNL wasn't a thing in Australia. Yep. But I loved Wayne's World. But yeah, Sleepwalkers ads were playing on TV, was dead keen to see it. It was opening the weekend we left, didn't get to see it, got back to Australia. My sister finally took me to the movies when it finally opened in cinemas, which was a good 2-3 months later from memory, and we went and saw it, and I fucking loved it. I loved it because Alice Krieg was in it, and I've always been a Ghost Story fan. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
And it had Madge Kanabnik, and I was a massive Twin Peaks fan as a kid. Yeah. Like, that was the era of Twin Peaks, yes. So I was still a major fan of her. And Brian Krause, I had no idea who he was, but I knew who Stephen King the fuck was.
Yeah.
And Mick Garris, of course, you know, having come off the back of Critters 2, I think at the time, would have been his previous feature prior to doing this. I was super hyped, and it did not disappoint. I loved it at the movies. Dug it when it came out in video, and it was slightly extended. Could not tell what was extended about it, but didn't matter. But my favorite memory of seeing this film was last year, September last year. I saw this film for its 25th anniversary at the Aero Theater, where the scene where Tanya, Madge and Amick's character.
Is it Tanya or Tonya?
No, it's Tanya, but it's Tanya on her badge. Everyone calls her Tanya, but it's written T-A-N-Y-A.
Because I thought there was
a YA. So it is definitely Tanya, but yeah, it's pronounced Tanya. Yeah. But
because you did that as well with Joe Dante. You call him Dante.
Why are we bringing this up now? This feels like we did this. This podcast earlier in this year, which never happened, folks. It didn't happen. No, but it's definite. It's definitely pronounced Tanya in the film, but it's written Tanya on the badge.
Because it's Joe Dante, not Joe Dante. Well, so I don't know if I can take your word for it that it's Tanya and not Tanya.
You need to watch this film again. But is it
their accent or is it just...
No. It's the Americans. I guess they just pronounce
Tanya
as Tanya. I don't know. Even though the film Tanya I, Hardy. Tanya is... Yeah, but that's with an O.
Yeah, but that's with an O. With an that's O. True. That's Tanya.
Anyway, let's tackle that Joe Dante thing. When
I really feel like I need to cut that out. I really feel like I need to cut that out.
Let's get to that at another point. But I will mention my favorite screening.
Do you want to block that out?
Let's just keep moving. I think we're moving somewhere. We're getting there. Is having seen this film for its 25th anniversary last year at the Aero Theatre, which is the cinema that's featured in the start of the film where Tanya... is working and first approached by Brian Krause's character Charles, and
which PS is where I completely fell in love with Madge and Abby.
Oh, absolutely,
and particularly her hair.
Hang on, let's touch on that when we talk about our favorite scenes, because it's going to be one of my favorite scenes. But getting to see the movie in the cinema in which that sequence shot is pretty special. Mick Garris was there, did a Q&A. It was great, very insightful. But the other funny and cool thing was a mate of mine, Ben Helwig, who I work with. We were in line to get some snacks from, the concession stand. And I was like, oh, you got any Dr. Pepper? And then they said, no Dr. Pepper. And then Mick Garris was behind us. And Mick Garris leans in and goes, have you got any Mr. Pibb? And Mr. Pibb is obviously the drink that Brian Krause wants when he does the movies in the movie. And I was like, fucking, that is super meta nerd.
Yeah.
I just wanted to high five him there on the spot and go, oh.
At this point, cool. At this point, did he know who you guys were?
Yeah, because I'd already met him in the street. Because prior, we got out of the Uber and I'd seen the marquee and it had Sleepwalker's 25th anniversary. Like, get those fucking photos. Gonna put that on the Insta later. Yeah. It's awesome. And then Ben got a shot of me under the marquee and I was like, that's awesome. And I'm like, should we go get some food? And he's like, yeah, let's go get some food. So then we're walking across the crosswalk and we bump into Mick Garris. I'm like, oh... Hey Mick, don't know if we'll see you later, but I just want to have a chat and get a photo. I want to sign my Blu-ray.
Well, I hope
he was a really good dude. Really
I was going to say, was he a solid? Because I always get the impression that Mick Garris is one of the good guys.
He strikes me as the kind of guy that started off as a fan, became obviously a journalist, filmmaker, all that he's
special
done,
effects,
everything. Star Wars. He's done everything.
Star Wars, yeah.
But yeah, he's super super receptive to fans.
He's in what?
He's in the thriller film.
Yeah, he is. Super receptive to fans. Well, very friendly and just an awesome guy.
Well, you motherfucker, I hope you mentioned that you were from Fake Shimp because he knows who
I
we
know.
Are.
Yeah, he knows who we are. Don't worry about that.
He'll be adding a few comments to this podcast a bit later on.
Oh, can't wait to hear what the man's got to say about the old Sleepwalkers. Bless
him. Okay.
So you were pushing me, man. You're pushing me. So Joe Dante or Joe Dante. No, I'm kidding. That's coming up later. Unless, of course, that is your favorite scene from the film, then you can address that right now. But what is your favorite scene from Sleepwalkers, Sean?
Probably that one, where she's dancing in the...
Okay, I thought you were going to say the cameo of all the filmmakers, Joe Dante / Dante.
Sean, was she dancing or was she dancing?
Dancing. She was dancing or dancing.
Yes.
It feels like...
Fantastic scene.
Yeah, I mean, but the cameo with everybody, where Clive Barker, Stephen King, Toby Hooper, it seems too obvious, for horror nerds to say, oh, that was my view. Of course, that's arguably one of the things that makes Sleepwalkers such a cult favorite is you finally get all these titans, sharing the frame together, the first time
in front of the camera.
That notwithstanding, the sequence in the cinema at the beginning where she's got headphones on and she's dancing, throwing her hair about.
It's one of my favorites. To Do You Love Me?
Yeah.
Yeah, she just loses herself in the music and is very sensual in the dancing and then very goofy when she bumps into Charles.
But it just feels so genuine. That's the thing. Cool. Doesn't feel forced. It doesn't feel self-aware. Just very honest, nice.
It's true.
Genuinely charming.
It's like she's
sequence.
Waited for the last person to leave the room. Yeah. Someone that she's working with. The people are in the cinema enjoying the movie.
So she can
she's
sing
in
the shower,
doing her own thing, And yeah, it's a beautiful
genuinely
moment.
It really makes me smile.
It's weird.
I see it.
It's like it for the movie. It is. That is one of my favorite scenes in the film.
Oh, completely.
It's just because it's just a nice scene. Like, it really sells that character to you. You're like, is she nice? Yes,
you got that right. She's like that. And when Garrus uses Enya. Because I'm a massive fan.
But hang on, hold the phone.
That's coming up.
Let's touch on the soundtrack a little later. Glenn, how about your favorite scene from Sleepwalkers?
I like everything in the first 10 minutes. Like, I love...
What about the other 80? Anything in there for you?
We're talking favorites here.
Okay, like, but Clovis doesn't even make a cameo in the first 10 minutes. Get that motherfucker.
This is like a Stacks-on episode, isn't it? Like, let's just target someone.
I know, everyone. I know.
Just one person after
it's a vicious circle. God bless it. Oh, yeah.
Can I continue?
Yeah, go
so
for it.
So, I like the Mark Hamill stuff at the start with the cat strung up. I just like that as an intro. But then it cuts to the intro of Brian Krause, and you've got the song Sleepwalk.
Oh, by Joe... Santo and Johnny, yeah.
Yeah, which is the song in La Bamba when Richie Valens dies.
Yep, I've got that later on in here, so I'm glad that you got to that before I got...
Well, anyway, we can talk about it
on
later.
The soundtrack.
But I like that as an intro. It's really nice.
It's a great...
The song fits.
Great piece of music.
And the film begins with this, like, Nordic kind of text of what a sleepwalker is.
The definition of a sleepwalker,
I think the setup... And that again, we spoke about this on a previous podcast. Mm. That opening text is very Anthony Hickok's.
He likes to do that.
Yeah. So, you know, anyway, I like the entire setup to the film. And early on, I like when Glenn Shaddix, is it? The fat guy from Beetlejuice?
Yeah. Oh,
gets his hand ripped off.
Fucking oath.
Which is
awesome.
Other methods of currency or whatever. Yeah. And you're like, oh my God, the guy's a pedophile.
Which, P.S.
What a piece of shit.
I adore Sleepwalkers. I genuinely really, really enjoy it. But that is the one sequence that really irks me.
Really?
Well, yeah, because all that stuff with the pedophile teacher, it's completely extraneous to the film. You can literally take it out, and it means nothing to the story.
Because it happens within such close proximity. Like, had he not shamed that teacher so close to him, you know, killing the teacher, if that had become a bigger part of the story, like, oh my God, he's going to be found out because the teacher knows and the teacher's talking to people. But the bit in the class and the bit, you know, where old mate pulls him over and he has a chat to him, it all happens in the space of about 10 minutes. So he's not a real threat. There's no genuine stakes caused by that.
Yeah.
But I still find it really good because I really like
it. I mean, it is a great scene.
The teacher is actually on his side. He reads the, you know, the story in class and he's like, you know, talks about the story. A story has a beginning, middle and end.
Yeah.
You know, much like a box, you know. But a box.
Four-sided box,
because a box actually has six sides. Yeah. And then it's like immediately offsides him.
Yep.
It's like from that point on, it's like either I get your ass or I'm fucking gonna.
But it also it establishes Brian Krause's attitude. It does a few things there.
Yeah.
And like, I mean, the whole film is very incestuous. So there's already foul tone to the film.
Well, that opening sequence with the you know, the son and mother sequence, which is. Begins innocent and it leads into the incest so soon into it. It's so offsetting. You're like, oh my God.
It's really upsetting.
It really
it?
Is. Because like, you're like, oh, they're close. Oh my God, they're very close.
Yeah. Oh my God, they're sleeping with each other.
Like, they're going to the bedroom and fucking. Oh my God, there's some weird colored lights coming out of the bedroom window right now. Yeah. They're creating some intense fucking sexual activity right
it's
now.
It's really unsettling.
Yeah. Really strange. Yeah. Very strange. I just wanted to throw to two of my other favorite scenes. So, you know, you usually reserve it to one favorite scene.
So, are your favorite scenes essentially going to culminate to the whole film?
No, it's the other 80 minutes, Glenn. So it's the bit with Officer Andy and Clovis when they first spot Charles. And he speeds by in the Trans Am and he says, come on, boy, get that bad guy. Get that motherfucker. I love it. I love it. Also, like Ron Perlman when his arm snapped off and then Mrs. Brady, Alicia Krieg, uses that arm to beat him with, and she also kills another man with a corn cob, which I also quite like as well.
Oh, yeah,
there's a lot of things I love about this movie, but these are some scenes that really stand out.
I remember when I was a kid, I was thinking, smart 12-year-old. I'm like, that must be like a nod to Children of the Corn, which was also Stephen King.
You know,
like,
I never even thought of that. That's
because
clever.
This would have been about the time of Children of the Corn 3 as well.
Was that Urban Harvest or was that what was that?
And that was Anthony Hickok's brother, James Hickok.
We're totally inceptioning this thing, aren't
we? Yeah.
Mental. Themes in this movie, well, we touched on incest. I mean, that's pretty evident early in the piece.
That's the one that you walk away with.
I kind of wrestled with this, though, was you know, that they're the last, well, they're not the last two sleepwalkers, but they acknowledge the fact that they haven't seen any other sleepwalkers for a number of years.
So they have to procreate.
Yeah, yeah, with one another. And my initial thought was, do they just pose as a mother and son because that's the way they can move from town
that's
to town?
That's what I thought as well.
But I think no, because behind closed doors, they keep up that pretense of mother and son thing. So maybe it's all right in the sleepwalker
in
circles. If you, yeah, because there's so few of them, they've got to do that. I mean, like, dogs and cats do that to a certain degree, and obviously other weird animals do it as well.
Adam and Eve, that's all I'm going to say.
There you go, Adam and Beef. So, yeah, the whole incest thing, it's still pretty disturbing. It like, I mean, it just, every time you watch it, leaves like a sour taste in your mouth. You're like, how can I enjoy this sex scene if it's mother and son?
And horror is supposed to sort of push the envelope and upset you in different ways. And when this film comes along and upsets you in that manner.
Yeah. You know, really, like, really. Yeah.
It kind of... It's
but a, it also has that kind of very typical Stephen King theme of... sort of
family bonding.
Summer of Corruption.
Right. Okay.
You know, like that. That's a very... Yeah, yeah. You know, I mean, even I think that was one of the short stories in Stephen King's different seasons. The Summer of Corruption. It was turned into Apt Pupil. That's very typical. It's like over the course of a summer, and that's Maginamic. You know, she learns the world isn't quite what she thinks it perhaps is, but then at the same time, Brian Krause learns that he's perhaps not as powerful as he's supposed to be, and that's what I took away from it.
I was going to say, well, because he raised that point, I was thinking about the fact that, you know, incest is a common topic in Stephen King, at least in adaptations.
But it's
that
usually
I've
in a negative
books.
Way. Like,
oh, obviously, yeah, definitely. Like, I mean,
the father.
Henry Thomas recently in the adaptation of
Gerald's
Game. Yeah, and then I rewatched about Dolores Claiborne, which is part of that Eclipse trilogy. Yeah. So yeah, it's a common reoccurring sort of theme.
What's the third part? Trilogy.
It's a book that hasn't been adapted yet. Right. I can't recall what it's called.
No, neither can I. It's driving me crazy.
Interesting. But anyway, so there's that. Other themes are like loneliness, outsiders, because you've got the mother and son. You know, they're outsiders. But also Tonya's character, she considers herself to be quite lonely and an outsider as well. And she addresses that with Charles in the cemetery. She sort of said, you know, your story. You know, do you really feel like an outsider? Do you really feel lonely? Because I do.
Yeah.
That sort of thing as well. So that it's sad too, because you almost feel like at a point in time, you know, there could be something between these two. He is so reluctant to want to pursue anything with her. Like, you know, when it starts getting a bit heated and a bit sexual in hometown and, you know, in the cemetery where everyone fucks. you know, he says to her, you know, like, maybe we shouldn't do this. And she's the one that encourages it. But even the mother, you know, sort of pushes and he's like, could it be someone else? And she's like, no, her. So, you know, there's genuine feelings.
Yeah, it's a strange turnaround, isn't it?
He can see something, you know, in her that's different from others and whatnot. So, yeah, it's kind of sad. So, I mean, there's a lot of thematic stuff sort of happening in this film. But getting onto the music, Sean, now tell us a little bit about the
old Enya. Yeah, I love Enya.
What's it called? Bodicia?
Bodicia?
Bodicia.
Or something like
Bodica.
That? Yeah. Oh, okay. Bodica, okay, yeah.
Bodica. Come on,
yeah.
Sean.
How's it go? Sorry, yeah, give us a rendition.
Bum ba dum dum. Bum ba dum dum.
Yeah. It doesn't sound anything like that. Really like I sung it better on the toilet.
It's much more haunting
theme.
It is very.
It's a haunting theme.
And I'm a massive Enya fan.
Right.
It's very Lost Boys-ish.
Yeah,
it is.
Yeah. Even a bit Titanic-ish. I do remember hearing Mick Garris at the 25th anniversary Q&A talk about the song and saying that
it was like a random.
Yeah, well, yeah. Sony had basically said, here's this music we've got, and you need to use something of this music in the film because we've got to sell records.
Mm.
You know, and I guess it was Columbia Pictures that was owned by Sony maybe at the time. I think Coca-Cola had sold Columbia by that point to Sony.
Mm.
Anyway, he went through it all and I think selected obviously the Enya piece. But I think the song just suits the film. Like
it just
tone,
works.
It just
works.
It not only
so
suits
well.
The film, it could belong in any horror film. Like it's
no,
just,
totally.
It lifts the atmosphere.
Like, it feels like it's written for a genre film. Doesn't feel like it's just a piece of Enya music.
Yeah, like anything.
Sail away.
Anything with like fog or, you know, like cemetery.
Like some sort of dread building, dread sort of thing. Incredible track.
Very gothic.
Absolutely.
Yeah, very gothic, yeah.
Absolutely. And obviously we mentioned earlier that Sleepwalk by Santo and Johnny that was featured in La Bamba, you know, and it's a song that's stayed with me ever since I've seen
La
Bamba.
If I'm not mistaken, that's a song that doesn't have any lyrics at all. It's just a musical piece. It's a musical piece. And it was a pop song at the time. It was sort of, you know, really?
Massive hit song.
Even Drilling Banjos. Drilling Banjos was number one.
Yeah.
Like, you know, the same thing. No,
but that was made famous from a movie. This was a song that
this
actually existed in the 50s.
Yeah.
And it was performed on Ed Sullivan or whatever. And, you know, it was like huge, but it had no lyrics. It was just a piece of music.
Curious, right?
Yeah.
Interesting. Well, on that note, I think it's time maybe we listen to a word from our sponsor.
Viewlorium is the place to stream cult movies for free. Like, I'm talking mutated sharks, megastorms, exploitation, low-budget indies, and shit tons of other stuff. Like, Viewlorium boasts a huge selection of the good, the bad, and the weird in between. FakeShep.net uses their service. Guilty as charged. Be rad like them. Viewlorium. Alternative streaming. Visit Viewlorium.com. Like, what now?
Coming up on the next episode of Franchise, we watch all four of the Lethal Weapon movies and discover that we're not all on the same page with this one. We hop, skip and jump between all four installments, as well as a side note about the TV series, and we have a laugh about all of the political incorrectness. Lethal Weapon, is this the greatest buddy cop film of all time?
Ooh. I think that's Canine, isn't it?
canine PI? Diplomatic immunity.
Yeah.
But you're black.
But you're black.
Yeah, oh my God, it made me laugh.
But Joe Pesci was introduced as Leo Getz. Okay. Jump onto our website at fakeshamp.net and have a listen to all of our previous episodes, which include Rambo, National Lampoon's Vacation, House, Psycho, and The Karate Kid, amongst others.
Get the bad guy. Come on, Quilvis. Here we go.
Get that motherfucker! Good boy, Clovis. Clovis.
So director Mick Garris, he got his start pretty much working as, a freelance film critic. You know, he worked on Cinema Fantastic, and then he hosted a cable access film program with interviews with filmmakers, one of my favorite being Fear on Film, which is on the Videodrome DVD and Blu-ray, where he's got interviews with, I think it's pretty much like a roundtable discussion with David Cronenberg, maybe John Landis.
Maybe John Landis is on the panel, yep.
Joe.
Well, because Joe Dante. Well, it's because he was he cameoed in The Howling. He was in one shot in The Howling.
Hollywood history goes back so ridiculously far.
Crazy, isn't it? Yeah. He's friends with everybody.
It's true.
I think didn't he get his start making movies because he'd done special effects. He's working on special effects and Star Wars.
He was doing set hand stuff and working on EPK stuff.
Well, then he started moving into EPK. So he did The Making of The Thing, which is one of his most famous ones, and The Howling, and he sort of navigated his way through. Mm. But he's become like the Stephen King.
But you know, it's because he's a nice guy. He's gotten so far. People want to work with him. Everything from he was in charge of R2-D2 at the Oscars. Doing all these. The most Stephen King adadaptations than anyone else.
That's it. Well, then, you know, obviously all of that led on to being a screenwriter. He did things like Batteries Not Included and The Fly 2.
Yep. Hocus Pocus. So,
Hocus Pocus. Actually, I'm glad you mentioned Hocus Pocus because Hocus Pocus was made, this year is the 25th anniversary, so it's 93.
Yeah.
So Sleepwalkers and Hocus Pocus are only a year apart, and there are so many similar sort of things between Hocus Pocus and, believe it or not, Sleepwalkers. You got the main thing, obviously, the witches. They need to drain the life force of a virginal youth to restore their strength and their beauty or their youth. And similar, in fact, to the Sleepwalkers and why they need to, you know, obtain young, nice girls, aka innocent virginal young girls, which I think is kind of funny that they're only a year apart and you've got that sort of similar thread between the two. But look, Mick Garris, I just wanted to ask you guys, you know, this is his, you know, I mentioned earlier, second theatrical feature following Critters 2. And it's the last studio film he did. Yeah, after this, he did more studio films. Yeah. Just did like made TV
wasn't
movies.
Wasn't it his only
films.
Studio film? Was the first one actually a studio film?
Well,
it was independent.
I think Critters 2 is a studio film because it's New Line Cinema, and New Line Cinema at the time were massive. That was post. It was like Critters 2 would have been, what, 88? 87, 88?
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, this we're about four films into the Nightmare on Elm Street franchise.
It probably wasn't regarded part of the studio system, I guess.
They weren't owned by Warner at that point, but they weren't too far off.
But I get your point.
Warner acquired them. But yeah, the last studio film he did. But, gents, what, like, Glenn, I'll cross to you first. Mm. What was your favourite Mick Garris, you know, be it a feature film that he's done or a TV miniseries?
Oh, look, I think, Critters 2 is just like, there's not many Easter horror films.
I was going to say, it's the number one Easter horror film of all time.
So definitely that. Oh, geez, trying to think. I think he's an audacious director because I liked what he did with The Shining reboot TV movie. I don't think it's like a great film by any means. But
no, I really like it, though.
It's trying to be faithful.
It's trying to be more faithful to the source, and I think it does a good job of that.
Yeah, exactly.
Definitely.
Yeah. P.S., for those that are interested, if you ever get your hands on a DVD copy of The Shining...
You're willing to buy it for $5.
PayPal. I've got it, but
right.
Listen to the audio commentary by Stephen King. Stephen King does an audio commentary on it. Yeah,
and he loves it.
He really, really digs it. In fact, he introduces himself like at the beginning of the commentary. He goes, "Hi, my name's Stephen King, and I wrote the damn thing." Like,
that's awesome.
It's very cool.
But you know, I also I've lost track of what the fucking movie was that he made that I loved. Bag of Bones, the one with Pierce Brosnan recently.
Yeah. Was that one of the like made for TV sort of TV miniseries?
It might have even been like a Hallmark film or something. It was something weird, but it was a really decent adaptation. It was scary as fuck. Like it made me jump quite a few times.
And again, quite faithful to the book as well.
Yeah, totally.
And really into Mick's career as well, because that was like only
deep into his career.
Oh, this is like one of his more recent, because he then moved to television for a few years. Yeah. What about you?
I think probably a toss-up between The Stand.
Of course.
I think The Stand is remarkable, and you know, I'm a big fan of the book as well, but I think that the Mick's adaptation is arguably the best Stephen King adaptation there is, and as a result, I genuinely believe it is. I think it captures the tone of Stephen King as well as anything that's been out there, and it also gives you the space to breathe.
Yeah,
because it's 6 hours; it's not condensed into like 90 minutes, and you know, and if it's not The Stand, then I'd probably say Riding the Bullet. I think Riding the Bullet's really underrated. It's
a very unsuspecting little film, that one.
Yeah, it kind of creeps up on you, and it's really heartfelt, and it gets its emotional hooks into you, and it's classy. Like Mick Garris directs it a real classy way. Like it's, and I know that it's Mick Garris, as I understand it, made it around the time where he lost one of his parents, and you know that's what the film is about. You know, this kid trying to deal with loss and grief and moving on and all. But as a result, you feel like Mick Garris has his hands on the material, you know, he understands it, and it comes through. So there's a confidence there that really appreciate.
Outside of everything he's directed, like he's got so much more influence on the horror genre than that. And I think like his Masters of Horror series
is unreal.
It's, you know, next to Tales from the Crypt, it's like the pinnacle of horror for television.
I agree.
You know, it pushed every envelope, and there's a reason it didn't, no, survive, is because it was just too extreme.
Oh yeah, the idea of getting all those guys together. Mm. I mean, like the names that came out of that you know, Joe Dante, and
Toby Hooper, Coscarelli,
John Landis,
Takashi Miike, John Carpenter with my favorite episode,
Cigarette Burns, amazing,
love it.
Takashi Miike, his episode's incredible.
His episode they couldn't even air.
Imprint's next level.
Yeah.
Like,
and then, but then
the idea of getting them all together,
other people
for one
into
series.
The third season was turned into Fear Itself, and there was a lot of people that came along for that one.
Mm. Yeah,
and then
a younger breed of the new Masters.
Yeah,
yeah,
and then he did Masters of Science Fiction, which he was only an executive producer, but that was, once again, it brought the sci-fi people across, you know. So
he's got another anthology working out just now, doesn't he?
He does.
It's about to drop.
Nightmare Cinema. It's been playing a bunch of
but that's a film,
festivals.
Isn't it?
It is a feature. It's a feature anthology in sort of like Creepshow fashion. I've actually seen it, and it's fantastic.
Have you really
dug it. Yeah, we really want to get it for Monsterfest in Melbourne this year. And Mick's been awesome about trying to get it. It's just, we're just trying to work out the finer details with the international sales agent.
Oh, really?
But we would love to have it this year at the festival, because it was one of those films that every one of us in the office that watched it, and it's very rare that we're all on the same page about a film. It's happened. In my mind, it's actually only ever happened maybe twice before, and that's pretty much The Greasy Strangler and Mandy. And so they're very different films, and for us to all be on the same page about Nightmare Cinema, it is a bang-on anthology horror that is like a throwback to The Creep Show, that style of anthology horror that you grew up through the 80s and 90s with, not one of these contemporary anthology horrors like ABC's The Death or... Field Guide to Evil or something that's
VHS,
you know, or VHS. It's a little bit too, you know, pretentious and forgets about what it was about. Like, you know, typically anthology horrors succeed because they have an element of humor and a lot of horror about them, and it's a good cross, you know, of those two. But they all the films really work well together. It's got a great wraparound, and I fucking really dug it, and I hope that we can get it because it would be great for Australian audiences
How absurd that, like, it's not a logical, you know, full-blown conclusion that when we get to Australia that we've got to find a genre festival like Monsterfest. Like, it should be a no-brainer you know, you guys will get it because, I know it's where it belongs.
It's tough, and we've been trying, and as I said, Mick's been really great about trying to get this film to us.
Yeah.
Because we've been sourcing. Like, Ben and I saw Mick do a panel about it, I think it was October last year in LA, and we saw the panel, we saw, like, the trailer, and we're like, oh my god, it was already on our radars, but we saw the trailer and we're like, we've got to get this. And then we chased it for months, and Grant at Monsterfest has been working with Mick on it, and just to have that one hold up that it comes down to, like, you know, this third party that's holding the film up kind of sucks, because it'd be awful if this film ends up on VOD, say, in the US, and ends up torrented, and people are going to illegally download it just because they want to see it, and they're going to miss getting to see it with a whole crowd on a big screen.
Well, the way it should be done.
That happened to Tales of Halloween.
Like, oh, I did, totally. Yeah. Because that ended up, it was picked up a roadshow, and they dropped it via Reel, and Reel put it out on DVD.
Unceremoniously.
Totally. And that's the nature of these bigger distributors in Australia will acquire product because they know it's a hot, you know, property, and then they do nothing with it, and they drop it to DVD, typically months after it's done digital overseas, and people have legally downloaded it, they've seen it, and so if they've liked it enough, they'll buy it, sure, but in this sort of declining physical market... more often than not, no, they won't. So, we really hope we'll get it ahead of any kind of, you know, digital release overseas.
Hey, everyone. Sorry to interrupt. It's Glenn here. Since we recorded this episode, the good news is that Monsterfest have secured Nightmare Cinema. It will be screening as part of the festival on November 23rd. That's a Friday night at 6:30 p.m. So head over to monsterfest.com.au to get more information and book your tickets before it sells out.
But I just wanted to mention, obviously, my favorite Mick Garris feature is Sleepwalkers. I fucking love them.
Of course, it is.
I've had an affinity with it. But I do also want to throw mention to, I actually really like Fly 2. He only wrote the screenplay for The Fly 2, but it's like a bold sequel, because who the fuck makes a sequel to David Cronenberg's The Fly? It's a perfect movie. It's one of my all-time, it ranks in my top 10 all-time favorite films.
Wow.
It's in my top 10, but it's actually not my favorite Cronenberg film, but it's one of my favorite films. So
yeah, I get
my favorite film outweighs my favorite Cronenberg film. I love it.
Just out of curiosity, what is your favorite Cronenberg film?
Ah, it's a good question. It changes every day of the week, but it's either Scanners... or The Fly, or Shivers. I don't know, it could be any number of Videodrome. It's going to keep changing. It's a sad state of affairs, but I love Cronenberg a lot. But I really like what he did with The Fly too, because it's a film that really doesn't open itself up too much for a sequel. He found ground to make, you know, a story out of it. And, you know, and it's creative, and it you know, it exists, and he does what it does.
He had the respect in the horror world to do it too.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Like, if someone's going to do it, well, our friend Mick, you know.
Yeah, let Mick do it. And it's 3 years after the original, and, you know, and that was an era, obviously, unlike now, where there's social media and blogs and all these other things. But even in that universe, it's 3 years after that Fly had become pretty much an immediate cult sensation. Yep. I fucking loved it since I very first saw it, you know. And so for this second film to come along and not actually have Jeff Goldblum, obviously, or Gina Davis, and be its own thing, and do a pretty good job of it. Eric Stoltz and Daphne Zangier, I think, too.
But Spaceballs.
And Spaceballs, of course. and The Initiation.
Who directed it? I don't remember.
Chris Wallace?
Yes.
He hasn't done much.
He's an effects guy, though. Effects, he was an effects guy that worked on the original Fly. Probably worked quite closely with old mate from Jason X. Because he was doing Isaacs. Effect stuff with Cronenberg at the time, so they probably worked together.
I think he's a guy, you think he did Arachnophobia and...
Did he do Arachnophobia?
I think so.
That's a cool film.
Yeah, I mean...
The most terrifying...
Fact check.
That might come up on a future podcast.
The most
down the
terrifying
track.
PG-rated film ever, by the way.
Yeah, it might come up on a future podcast.
It may do. I think I've even done a YouTube video about that one.
Ooh.
Yeah, Cinema Waffle. Yes. But I think he also did The Curse 3... from memory because I looked this guy up ages ago when I first watched
The Curse 3?
Yes.
Yeah, The Curse franchise. They're all unrelated to one another again.
Christopher Lee's in it.
Oh no, Christopher Lee. I thought he was in the second one, Curse 2. Oh no, he's in Curse 3 is the tribal one. Yes. Curse 2 is the bite, the one with the snake.
Yes.
What?
Have you not heard of The Curse films?
The first
Curse film's got Will Wheaton in it, and it's kind of part directed by Lucio Fulci. I think he directed part of it.
You would dig it, man.
I don't know.
It's
very hard to say. It's an odd franchise. It's a franchise by name only.
First one straight out of the 80s, and then the second one, this chick or guy gets bitten by a snake and then turns into a snake. His whole body turns into a snake. Yeah.
Actually, the first two are on Stan. So if you've got the Australian streaming service Stan. Yep, the first two films are on that. Sorry, I think you're going to have a tough time trying to track down.
Because
I don't know if it's had a release outside of VHS, but yes, it's got Christopher Lee in it.
Anyway, digression.
Digression, totally. Look, let's cross to Mick and let's hear about what his thoughts are on this absolute classic of a film.
Well, Sleepwalkers was a very unique experience for me. One, it's the first and only studio film that I directed, and secondly, it was the first time I ever worked with Stephen King. So it inspired me to get him together with a couple of my other friends I'd worked with who were kind of big in the genre. We knew this was a total genre film we were doing here and not a contender for the Academy Awards, but we had a great time doing it, and I tapped Clive Barker, whom I'd known for a while, and Toby Hooper, who was a very close friend, and got them all together in that graveyard, which is really a place right in the middle of, literally in the middle of Los Angeles. There's a marker for the center of Los Angeles, the city, in that park. So it was really fun. We shot that scene in 2 hours, and then King left. What he didn't know was that right before I was setting up for the scene, I broke my tooth on my morning granola and had to rush down and get a crown put on before he got there so I could function during the whole thing. It was interesting because it was an original screenplay. Another director had been hired before me, and he started changing everything and put in a planet of sleepwalkers and things like that. And the studio wasn't going to risk losing Stephen King's name in the title because they knew how much that was worth. And I had done a couple of movies really for television and one feature, but he had director approval, and he decided he really liked Psycho 4, and the studio liked the combination of us. They knew that I would really respect the work of King, which I did. And we had a blast on it together. We never met until we shot that cameo scene in the graveyard, which, like I say, was just a total blast. But it was very different working from an original script and not one of the novels or short stories. And yet, because he had written that script, I could make suggestions, and I did, and I wrote a couple of scenes in there, a couple of small things that he really liked. But you're not having as much flexibility as working from a novel or a story, because turning a book into a movie is much more flexible than turning a screenplay into a movie. Anyway, it was a great experience, and like I said, the first and last studio picture that I directed, although I've been working ever since in television and in independent features. It mainly was how I met King, and he was so happy with the experience that we went on to do The Stand after that, where we really got to be closer collaborators and friends, then The Shining and a bunch of things since. So I will always have great love for Stephen King and for Sleepwalkers.
Thanks, Mick, for that. So, Sleepwalkers, original screenplay by Stephen King, written for the screen by Stephen King. So I'm going to throw it to you guys again. A little bit about Stephen King, a little digression. What would be your probably your favourite adaptation, be it for the big screen or the small screen there, Sean?
Yeah, right. Like I said, I really adore The Stand.
There's so many facets to that question.
Well, I know, because it's like what well, kind of Stephen King? Do you want the drama Stephen King? Do you want the horror Stephen King?
How about you have a top three and you tell us why?
Top three. The Stand, because I think it pretty much perfectly captures Stephen King, particularly the characters of Stephen King.
Right.
Those kind of guys next door. Jesus Christ, I just don't know. The Mist, I really like The Mist.
Yeah, that's an excellent adaptation.
And I really like The Mist when Darabont dropped the black and white version. I don't know if you watched the black and white version.
Yeah, I couldn't do it.
You couldn't do it.
I hate watching films converted to
black
and white.
It's on the Blu-ray, but
it's like Fury Road, it's pointless.
I really dug it because it gives it that kind of 50s B-movie feel. I really dug the black and white Mist.
Well, it's funny. Mick Garris must have a bit of a relationship with Darabont because I think they do. Darabont had a pass on the Fly 2 script at
some
point.
They're in photos all the time together.
Okay.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Go figure. And then, dear God, I don't know.
Maybe just a top two.
I don't know. It's just the,
okay.
Shawshank Redemption, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, I think At Pupil for me is
a classic.
Right up there. I love that film.
I just rewatched that a couple of months ago. It stands up. Again, 20 film. Years old. Like it's
got quite a sort of sort rental. Of little backstory now, too.
Read about that. I got an ex-rental copy from McAdam Flicks.
Did you really?
I do. It was like amazing manager's choice. Manager's choice sticker on it too. Yeah, but yeah, no, I read that interesting backstory recently about the shower scene.
Yeah, it's
directed by Bryan Singer.
Yeah. Oh yeah, no, I know. I stumbled across it in one of my old empires from the time.
Mm. Yeah.
I'll see if I can find the article. I'll take a shot. I'll send it to you guys.
Back to me. I don't know. I'm staring at his catalog right now. Yeah. And look, I mean, you got Pet Sematary, which is a fantastic adaptation.
But also previously covered on a Rewind and Digress podcast.
Baby Misery.
Stand By Me.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Stand By Me is, but I don't think it's in my top three.
Do you know I really like Storm of the Century as well?
That's not an adaptation.
No, it's not.
That's an original script.
But that, if you were to ask me my favourite Stephen King films, that's top five.
Oh, yeah. I really like Storm of the Century.
And I'm going to say Carrie.
Yeah, okay. No,
good call. Yeah, good call.
Jarrett, what about you?
Okay. Well, I'm thinking number one, over the years, having spent so much time with my beautiful wife,
Maximum Danielle, Overdrive.
And having put up with me, I love Misery. It's her favorite Stephen King adaptation and probably her favorite Rob Reiner film.
In the book, the sledgehammer scene is an axe and she actually cuts the ankle, the feet off. Yeah.
What do they call it again? They call it hobbling. Yeah, no, hobbling. God, it's a great term because we always make a joke about it. It's always fun to make a good joke about some torture. Misery, my second favorite would probably be, I knew it a minute ago in my head, and Christine.
Yeah.
Christine, I fucking love Christine. I'm very excited. Christine's just about to come out in 4K, new 4K restoration, John Carpenter classic. I think it's magnificent.
That's the only Stephen King John Carpenter has touched, isn't it?
Yes.
I don't think he's done anything else.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. Should have been bigger than it was at the time. Obviously it's a massive film now. It's a cult film.
I seem to remember reading something or hearing something that John Carpenter didn't particularly like it because his attitude was, how do you make a car scary? But that just doesn't seem like it rings true anymore.
But he did it.
Yeah, he did.
Fucking nailed it.
Yeah.
Made it happen.
And we were talking about Cronenberg before. He did The Dead Zone.
Yeah, Dead Zone's a classic as well.
That's my favorite Stephen King.
I'm going to go with Sleepwalkers for three, but then, I'm going to throw a bit of a wild card out there.
Even though it's not an adaptation.
No, sorry. Yeah, okay. It's originally. Okay, so it's out of the game.
Yeah.
Okay, it's completely
out of the
game.
It's your game.
Okay.
You're making the rules, dude.
I mean, I could be choosing better films. And I mean, I appreciate that Brian De Palma's Carrie is a fucking amazing film. I love Stanley Kubrick's The Shining. I understand it differs
amazing
a
film.
Fair bit from The Source material. It doesn't really matter. That I fucking love. But, and I actually, this third one, I do love The Shining more than this, but I'm throwing this third one in there. And it's Maximum Overdrive because it's the only film that King's ever directed. And I fucking have always loved this movie, right down to the teaser trailer where Stephen King seems coked up just talking direct at the camera without his glasses looking cockeyed.
Because you sent me that link, didn't
you?
I'd
never seen it before. It's so good. But I love Maximum Overdrive. It's ridiculous over the top. It's even got a great cast. All good King adaptations have a King cameo, and it does have the King cameo at the start, where it's like, "Hey, honey, this machine just called me an asshole." Fucking love it. Emilio Estevez, Yardley Smith. It's got a great cast.
His cameos are always tacky as shit.
Did you ever see his cameo in Sons of Anarchy?
No.
Oh my god. So Sons of Anarchy is obviously about a bikie gang, right?
Yeah.
I won't go into it, but like somebody ends up dead, and they don't know how to get rid of the body, so they go, "I know a guy, let me call him." They call him, and Stephen King comes in, and he's
Stephen
just like,
King's the cleaner.
Yeah, he's the fixer. He comes in, and right. like it's a woman that's dead, so he picks up her hands and checks the weight, and he feels her breast to see if they're real, and he opens up her eyes, and and then just looks and says, "Like, it's going to cost $3,000." And so he's like, "I don't have $3,000. I'll see what I can do." And he goes, "Okay." And he comes back like 20 minutes later in the episode. They go, like, "Did you get rid of her?" And he looks at the woman and goes, "Get rid of who?" And she goes, "All I could get was $1,800, but here, and you can take something from the house to make up the difference." And Stephen King just gives her this dead stare, yeah. and then turns around, just sees this huge ornament, and just picks it up and puts it under his arm, and then walks out, and that's it. You never see him again.
Like, that's so good.
It's the best.
I love that.
But
he
you
takes
were talking about
Maximum
Overdrive. Do you know the backstory with the cinematographer with that one?
No.
There was a couple of accidents that happened on the set, and the lawnmower scene towards the start.
Oh god, yeah, it's a
classic. Yeah, so that lawnmower was a real lawnmower, and it hit a chunk of wood. Splinter from the wood flew off, hit the cinematographer in the eyeball. Blinded
that's where
for
you,
life.
Yeah, that's where you want a cinematographer to be.
Yeah. So he was blinded for life. He sued Stephen King, won, or they settled with an undisclosed amount.
Yeah.
But that guy, he only made one other film and then his career just died.
Oh. Wow, but he would have been sitting on a tidy sum of money. I mean, Stephen
You'd
King
think
and
so.
Dino De Laurentiis produced it, so there would have been money in that.
But yeah.
And I don't think Stephen King's a dick. I'm sure if there was an accident that happened and he realized, that would be losing my fingers.
In those days, he was a real dick.
Really?
Yeah, I guess it was a different era.
He was a cokehead and he was arrogant.
He was a degenerate alcoholic.
But he was everything.
I don't know this. Hey, I haven't partied with Stephen King, but Stephen King, if you're listening and you want to party, I'll be in LA next month. I'm totally up for it, dude.
He's besties with Mick.
Oh, well, there you go. Mick, hook us up. We'll have a party. I was going to say a three-way, but then it sounded too sexual.
Another thing that Mick and Stephen
King
worked
for Sleepwalkers, though.
Mick and Stephen King worked on the Michael Jackson Ghosts.
Of course.
They did.
Something that not a lot of people know.
Very, very cool. Well, guys, look, I don't really have much more to say about Sleepwalkers. I don't have that many more digressions. I do want to plug a few things, though, before we're out of here. Do you guys have any other words about Sleepwalkers before I just start plugging shit left, right,
plug
and center?
Plug it up.
Nice.
Carrie, love it. All right, so there is a Blu-ray coming from Scream Factory, and it may, in fact, by the time you're listening to this, already be released. This was the film that I never thought would get a proper Blu-ray release. I know this because Via Vision, who put out the Blu-ray in Australia, were interested in doing something a little special with it. But then when the effort, when it seemed like it was going to be an effort, they backed off a bit. Image in the States pretty much put out just what the studio gives them. So they put out a Blu-ray with a nice transfer and a trailer. And no one seemingly else wanted to do anything about it. I spoke to Scream Factory about it last year and said, why haven't you guys licensed Sleepwalkers and done a proper special edition? Like, working with Mick would be a dream.
Mm.
He's got heaps of stuff that he's, got, behind the scenes footage that his brother shot, all this stuff. And they said, look, dealing with Sony's really tough because they had to get clearances from everybody. So if you use anything or anything said about anyone, it has to go through so many channels. And because it's Sony, there's a lot of red tape about it and whatnot. Yeah. So, yeah, at the moment, it's just a title that we couldn't do. And I spoke to Mick Garris about it. Mick's like, yeah, I'm just waiting. I wish someone would do a special edition of it. Yeah, there hasn't been really any interest locally, in the States, that is. And he did mention that he tried to get something going with an overseas label, which I think was Via Vision, which we tried to coordinate with him.
Yep.
And they sort of backed off when they realized there was a bit of work involved. So I honestly never thought there would ever be a definitive edition of Sleepwalkers. I thought we'd just have what we'd have. But now Scream Factory putting out this definitive edition. They haven't announced all the special features yet, but as I said, by the time this podcast is out there, or even when you listen to it, it'll be out there.
God bless.
But I know
Scream
they've done
Factory.
A commentary.
Mm-hmm.
Mick Garris has done a commentary. I hope that Brian Krause is on it.
Yeah.
I hope Magic and Amic's on it. I don't know if Alice Krieg will be on it or what. But anyway,
let's hope Dan Martin's on it.
There's going to be a lot of special features on it, and I'm just like, that's amazing, because you know, this has been a long time coming. So, you know, I'll be super pleased. Danny will have to sit through Sleepwalkers again this year.
A sixth time this year.
That's fine. Yeah, but yeah. For me, it'll be the third time. I think for her, she's managed. She saw most of it the second time around this year. So, yeah, she won't dodge a bullet. She'll dodge
she'll ride the
very
bullet.
Special. Yeah.
She'll ride the bullet.
Jeez, this guy's full of puns. Like,
he is on top of it tonight,
so
isn't he?
Too quick-witted. So, look, let me throw some plugs out. I want to plug out the Miscellaneous podcast. I've guested on a couple of their podcasts. They're really great guys. They run a podcast, which I'm not entirely sure what it's about. But every time I go on it, I'm quizzed about stuff I know nothing about. Sometimes I win. Sometimes I lose, but I seem to win more often than I lose, which is pretty good. And they give me prizes.
It's a game format.
It's a game show format, and it's great. And they really give me a platform to advertise the Fake Shemp Net podcast and other podcasts that I don't do. Other things that I'm plugging. I don't know. Other podcasts I haven't told you guys about yet that I've just got waiting in the wings. I've recorded 67 episodes, and they're going live tomorrow. Aside from that, I want to shout out to Jesse from the Screaming Meaties, who provides our intro, outro, and some bed music. He's a champion, and we love him. And that's really it. Have you guys got anything you want to plug
We have an interview with Nick Garris on the FakeShemp.net website. It dates back to maybe 2 or 3 years ago.
It's a
fantastic in-depth interview, all about everything from Batteries Not Included to, you know, everything else he's done, She-Wolf of London, the Wizard of Oz thing he did in Australia all that time ago. So, yeah.
Right.
Check it out. It's in the interview section.
Cool. I guessed it on Chatflix podcast one more time. Those guys are great. If you haven't listened, then you really should.
You guys are cheating on me.
Yeah, I know.
Well, it's particularly about the 67 podcasts I haven't told you either of you guys about yet.
But yeah, Chatflix. If you haven't, Chatflix is
It's a great podcast,
and it is. It's a lot of fun.
Very
really,
polished,
really charming guys, and really.
And they've got a deep affinity for the movie Dirty Dancing.
Yeah, they do.
They don't, actually. They hate it. But anyway, that's another topic for another time. No, I'm kidding. I like these guys.
And Ted Danson as well.
Ted Danson, yeah, Matt O'Neill. Oh, hilarious. Matt O'Neill kills on that. Matt O'Neill kills.
I love Matt O'Neill. Every time I hear that promo, it kills me.
It so kills me.
Yeah.
All right, then. Well, thanks for listening, and listen to us next time.
Please.
I was going to. Oh, get fucked.